by really plunging the reader into this rich and varied world of music combats the idea that women are a novelty.
Hi there, it's WAMC News Director Ian Pickus. And on this episode of the WAMC News Podcast, How Women Made Music.
Girls, you know you better watch out. Some guys are only about that thing.
One of us is changing, or maybe we just stopped trying. And it's too
Lauryn Hill, Bikini Kill, Carole King. Those are just some of the names you'll come across in the new book, How Women Made Music, A Revolutionary History from NPR Music. The book is part reclamation, part encyclopedia, and part critical reconsideration of some of the names, bold and otherwise, whose impact on music hasn't always gotten its due. And Ann Powers and Allison Fensterstock, both longtime NPR Music contributors, join us now. Welcome.
Thanks so much for having us.
Yeah, thank you so much.
So what got you all working on this project?
Well, this is Anne talking. And I guess back in 2015, we first had a conversation, Allison, myself, and our friend Jill Sternheimer, about sort of the place of some of our favorite women in the popular music consciousness, really. Like, why are certain women forgotten or underestimated? And why, even though there's been a million, you know, declarations that this is the year of women in music, why do we always find women marginalized and sort of underrepresented? So we decided to take on a project in which we not only centered women, but we really only focused on women and thought about what would it be like if the history of popular music in the past 125 years was told through their stories. Say, hey, leave the Beatles. They're great. You know, Rolling Stones, fine. We'll come back to them another time. Let's focus on the women. And out of that came our project, Turn the Tables, and eventually this book.
And Allison, what's gained in that process for you?
Well, I mean, I think for me and hopefully for all of our readers, it's a worthy reconsideration because it's the Turning the Table started with a list. We made the list of the 150 greatest albums of all time by women, which I think the three songs you played in your intro all came from that. It was just this exercise in subverting this really masculine tool of music ranking, which always says, oh, you know, Jimi Hendrix is at the top, and then the Beatles, and then the Stones. You're like, what if we just made them ineligible? What if they were decentered? What would the rest of that list look like? And, I mean, Anne's working hypothesis that you could tell the entire story of Western pop music history and all of its innovations with only women proved to be more than true. So, I mean, I think it's an exercise for everyone's brain to look at things a little bit differently. And hopefully it's like an exercise for their ears to just enjoy some sounds.
Now, the book makes this point in a few different places, and so have you in our conversation just now. But a lot of times in music history, women are treated as kind of a curiosity or a novelty. So this is a bit of a two-edged sword. How did you avoid that dynamic in putting this project together?
Great question. I want to go back to something you said in your introduction. You used the word encyclopedia, and I love that because I don't know about you, but when I was a little kid, I loved looking at encyclopedias, and really, those kinds of books opened the world to me. And the same was true of the history of music. Things like the Rolling Stone, you know, 500 Best Albums, or the Spin Alternative Record Guide, you know, these books, Rolling Stone Illustrated History of Rock. That's how I learned what I thought was the full history of popular music. And I am very proud that this book can sit on the shelf with those books and maybe be a world, maybe show a world to a reader who, you know, is a casual music fan. And then for those who are more serious, like intense music fans, I think many of the views expressed in this book, many of the essays with their really original takes on familiar artists, will change the way people think about these artists. And that in itself, by really plunging the reader into this rich and varied world of music, combats the idea that women are a novelty.
Let me direct this next question first to Allison. You know, like right now in music, the biggest artists are all women, really. And they're having a huge year. I mean, we had Brad Summer and Taylor Swift is selling out arenas and so on. So historically, looking back over the decades covered in this book, I mean, is it that audiences didn't have an appetite for so many women in music, or have we just been misjudging the listening audience?
To be like a little bit of a history nerd, this happened before. I mean, the very beginning of recorded music sales, all of the top sellers were female blues vocalists. Like Bessie Smith was, you know, the first Chapel Roan.
Well said. Very well said.
In more ways than one, I guess, honestly.
Yeah, exactly.
And then in the 60s, like or very early 60s, which is a period that's very dear to my heart, is the girl groups had total primacy, you know, with listeners and on the charts. So it comes and goes again and again. I think we all, like, we have this amnesia about sort of the 70s, like, singer-songwriter masculinity era as, like, that's what rock was, which is probably because that's when the rock press really took hold.
But even so, I have to say, even movements or subcultures that we associate with, you know, very masculine aesthetics and ideas, like punk, for example, I don't know. I fancied myself a punk when I was in high school, and yeah, I love The Clash, but who were my role models? Chrissy Hynde, Debbie Harry, later on the artier side, Kate Bush. So the women are always there. It's just a matter of if you are listening for them. Mm-hmm.
Do you think we will reach a point, or are we at that point now, where sex and gender won't loom as large in how music is categorized?
Oh, well, will we reach that point in society in general, in humanity? This is the way in which music culture reflects and is reflected by the larger culture, which I think this book really tackles.
And I think we're at least in a really great upswing of just reconsidering the gender binary and just ideas of masculinity and femininity and art, which, again, when you really look at the history, that's happened before. Again, going back to the 70s, you know, in glam rock, that was happening in a different way. And I think, I mean, I don't know if it'll stick or if there'll be like a backlash or not, but we go through these waves in how people express themselves creatively and how people respond to it. And right now, I think it's setting up this wonderful world of like possibilities and role models for whatever the next generation is going to be.
Can you each tell us one person from this book who you think isn't, you know, so well known to the public and made a big impact?
Okay, you asked us that kind of question where we're like, both of us are like, give me 10 minutes.
No, I'm gonna cheat and go with an essay by me. Because I live in New Orleans. I used to be a music writer at the New Orleans paper, and I included an essay about Irma Thomas, the soul singer from New Orleans, who actually just, she had a huge hit in the early 60s when she recorded Time Is On My Side first, and the Rolling Stones had a huge hit with it. When the Rolling Stones headlined the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival this past year, they brought her up on stage. I think they wouldn't have been able to avoid it because New Orleans is like, that's her town. And she was very regal. And she was like, and now you all know, you know, to this audience of 20,000 people. She was like, and now like Mick is saying thank you for the song. And she said, you know, you're welcome, Mick. And I think, yeah, more people should know about her. I mean, even, you know, the songs she wrote herself, Beyond Time Is On My Side. She's an incredibly powerful singer.
I'm going to reach back a little bit in history and also cheat by talking about a woman who's kind of hidden in plain sight, and that's Marian Anderson, the great classical music singer. Marian Anderson is famous, of course, for defying the whites-only policies in Washington, D.C. back in 1939 when she performed on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. And we have a fantastic essay about the coat she wore that day. She wore a fur coat, and that statement, a black woman wearing a fur coat on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, said so much about dignity, about power. And Gail Wald, the historian, she's brilliant in analyzing this. And then in tracing other cases where women, where black women have worn fur coats to kind of claim their power, all the way up to Beyonce.
Well, we've been speaking with Ann Powers and Allison Fensterstock, NPR music contributors who are behind the new book, How Women Made Music, A Revolutionary History. We're very grateful for your time and your diligence. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Great questions.
Thank you.
Okay, that does it for this episode of the WAMC News Podcast. Thanks so much for listening. Until next time, I'm Ian Pickus.